little bit about this concept of body burden, because it's something that we've been talking about at Norwex, but just to help our audience understand what it is and how it, you know, accumulates over time, just to give that just by background, give them a little bit more info on body burden.
Yeah, well, I think maybe it's even useful to begin by comparing something like the coronavirus. Right? We worry about children and the rest of us being exposed to the coronavirus because once exposed, we can become infected. Well, it's really the same thing with these contaminants, these toxic chemicals. Through our food, through our breathing, through the house dust, we can be exposed to these toxic chemicals. Now, the one difference between most of these toxic chemicals, unless you get a really, really high dose, is that you don't see an infection like you do with coronavirus over the next 5 or 6 days. It's the chronic exposures that accelerates the wear and tear on our bodies or damages the developing brain, right? Because if you can imagine, the brain just over a few months goes from essentially nothing or one cell to billions of cells. And if you start damaging that by exposing the developing brain to toxic chemicals, at that early stage, it can have big implications. And so the body burden has really come about as a concern over the past 4 to 5 decades. Even when I was in training, we were taught that these low levels of exposures we have to chemicals like lead, they're safe, they're innocuous, don't worry about them. And it's really just been in the past 3 decades that we've begun to recognize that this big assumption we made 5 or 6 decades ago, that there are thresholds or safe levels for these chemicals, and that we don't have to worry about the concentrations of contaminants we're exposed to on a regular basis. What we've seen with lead, with air pollution, with flame retardants like PBDEs, like mercury, like PCBs and tobacco, is that there does not appear to be thresholds or safe levels. And when we measure these contaminants in pregnant women and children, we can measure hundreds of them. We're all exposed. We're like a chemical soup. And these are not the chemicals that make up human life. These are oftentimes synthetic chemicals that shouldn't be there in the first place. Or even when they're elements like lead and mercury that have been there since time began, but we're exposed to so much more than our pre-industrial ancestors because of the industrial process. And so now what we've seen is we are these chemical soups, and most of these chemicals have not been tested to find out whether they're toxic. That, in fact, is my job and people like me. The problem with that, though, is that we only study them after they've been exposed. So after millions or billions of people have been exposed, we study them and say, well, that's not safe. But it's a terribly flawed way to do it, because by default, that means people have already been harmed before we find out whether these chemicals are toxic.